Now, we're not going to talk about this specific black hole engine, but I can tell you about another one, which is super cool. There's only one conceivable technology that we have that could create such a thing. So let's talk about this space elevator. How realistic is it? What's going on, everyone? My name's Dylan Tanz. I'm a physicist from the land down under and currently doing research in astrophysics. I'm working on my first paper. I am a baby within academia and just getting started. So make sure you subscribe to follow my journey. I'll be making all sorts of kinds of videos in the future. But for now, we're just doing some reaction videos. And today we're checking out Foundation. I've been waiting for this show for a while now because it's written by Isaac Asimov. It's one of my favorite book series ever. And a fun little fact before we start, but you might recall when Elon launched his Tesla Roadster into space a few years back. Well, he actually put these little crystal-like storage devices in that car that contained all of the Foundation books, which is awesome in its own right, but it's even awesomer when you realize how relevant that is to this story. I'm not going to spoil anything. I'll let you guys figure that out for yourselves. These visuals are just incredible.
Well, the grav generator's output a waveform that corrupts the jump drive's ability to plot fourth-dimensional points at trans-dimensional speeds.
What? I've got no idea what any of that meant. No, I caught some of the words, but the trans-dimensional? That's not a real thing, bro.
You claim your plan can reduce the coming darkness.
An Encyclopedia Galactica. After the fall, a civilization climbs from the ashes. A foundation. They won't have to reinvent the wheel. The knowledge will already exist.
The good old Encyclopedia Galactica. If you've watched any Carl Sagan, you would have come across this thing. He loved talking about that. And the golden record on Voyager. And Voyager 1 and 2 are kind of like our calling card to, if there is an Encyclopedia Galactica already out there, which there very well could be. Who knows, maybe there's like a Wi-Fi link to the Encyclopedia Galactica that we just haven't found yet. You know, it's, maybe it's only in certain parts of the galaxy. It's definitely a possibility. And I'm only talking about our little island, our galaxy, the Milky Way. There's a whole lot of islands in a vast ocean out there with, you know, voids in between. Definitely, possibly something going on somewhere else in the universe. And I think it would be a great idea to start building up some kind of backup, like an Encyclopedia Galactica for just our species.
Yes, it is. I'm a bit nervous.
How's the New Zealand accent on her?
Synax. Picked up just a hint of it in your accent.
Fish and chips, bro. Australians can do Kiwi accents pretty well.
Are you praying?
They're prime numbers.
No, why?
I only know that because I've read the books.
Your lips were moving.
Yeah, when I'm nervous, I count primes.
So she's basically a computer because that would be, like, impossible. And if you don't know what's so special about prime numbers, they're kind of called, like, the atoms of math. The atoms of numbers, at least. And that's because you can build every other number from prime numbers, multiplying them together. So they're like the hydrogen and oxygen of numbers.
As she was proposing a radical theory about rings of integers and non-Archimedean local fields.
Rings of integers, can't say I know what those are. A mathematician in the, watching this, help me out in the comments. It's probably no mathematicians left because I said that people get into math because they like puzzles and shit in one of my videos. So I imagine that they would have left the room. But on the topic of math, though, I don't show much of it in these videos, and there's a very specific reason for that. Math is just a tool, and one should learn to hold the physical concepts in one's mind without reference to the mathematical form. That's a quote by Dirac. That looks pretty cool. That looks like it. Is that a black hole? Nice. Now, we're not going to talk about this specific black hole engine, but I can tell you about another one, which is super cool. There's actually quite a few ideas around how we can use black holes and to get energy from them. And theoretically, it's possible, but there's some limitations. So this engine involves something called a Kugelblitz, which literally translates to ball lightning. And a famous physicist in the 50s, John Wheeler, basically predicted that if you could dump enough energy into a specific region of space, you could create a microscopic black hole that would be described by the equations of Schwarzschild. So this is what we call a Schwarzschild Kugelblitz, or an SK. And then like 20 years after that, Stephen Hawking realized that quantum mechanical effects around black holes, specifically on its event horizon, that region which, you know, not even light can escape. If you go near it, you're bloody stuffed. It would be emitting some radiation, this region, called Hawking radiation. We're not going to go too much into it. But the weird stuff about this Hawking radiation is that the smaller the black hole, the greater this radiation. So for these engines, it would actually be better to have a microscopic black hole. We don't know if these microscopic black holes even exist. If they do, they probably evaporate pretty quickly. And now if you bring together these two ideas, you know, the Schwarzschild Kugelblitz by Wheeler and Hawking's radiation, well, you can imagine a new type of interstellar spacecraft, one that's fed by the power of a Kugelblitz. To be useful though, these things would have to be small enough to emit enough radiation that we can use, that have to be light enough that we so we can reasonably accelerate it, and that also have to be large enough so it doesn't evaporate instantaneously. So you'd probably need one like smaller than even a proton. And that sounds pretty small, right? It would still be really heavy, like two giant skyscraper buildings. That's how heavy it would still be. But if you work this out, you get a nice amount of energy. It works out to be New York City's 2013 July's energy consumption times 10 million. Then there's also the problem of energy efficiency. Like if you capture 100% of the energy, if you imagine something called a Dyson shell, we're not going to go into what that is, but it's like this little shell, you encase the black hole in, let's just imagine it gives you 100% energy efficiency. You're capturing all of it. Well, within the 5-year lifetime of this proton sized SK, well, you could actually reach about 72% the speed of light. So with that sort of speed within a human lifetime, you could actually reach a few of the stars in the solar neighborhood. So it's still, you can see the problem we're facing with the vastness of space and the, you know, the limit of the speed of light. Before you can extract this energy from the SK, you need to be able to make it. And that's another problem. There's only one conceivable technology that we have that could create such a thing, and that's a gamma ray laser. Small problem. The output frequency of the laser would be roughly a billion times greater than what our current technology can produce, and the pulse duration would be about 100 billion times shorter than what we can currently achieve. So problematic. Which means the total energy of a single laser pulse from this thing would be equivalent to the amount of energy the sun puts out in 1/10 of a second. This might all sound really crazy, but it's really awesome. And I truly believe this stuff might just one day take us to the stars. It's pretty sad that we're not going to be around to see it. I know, trust me, I know, but you know what? We still have the dream, and at the end of the day, that's all that matters. Space elevator. Another thing that's in every sci-fi book. 14 hours. It's about the same time it takes to get to Australia from just about anywhere. So let's talk about this space elevator. How realistic is it? Might actually surprise you. And there's some new ideas out there. Like I said, I've read so much of this stuff in sci-fi. It is ridiculous. But it's actually a pretty great idea. So let me explain. So normally, you know, we get into space by rockets. Everyone knows that. But in Australia, we actually just untie our spaceships and they just fall into space. But if you're not lucky enough to be in Australia, well, it's going to cost you about $10,000 just to get a single kilogram into space. It's not cheap. And not to mention all the waste and propellant and all the greenhouse gases that come along with it when you're trying to get something into space from, you know, rockets. These space elevators could be completely powered by solar energy. They're always going to be, you know, have the sun available right there. But there is problems. The major problem being that, you know, what's this material going to be made out of? It would need to be really strong. And if we can ever make carbon nanotubes long enough, possibly. But it doesn't look like there really is any material that will be strong enough. And because we still don't have material strong enough to support a space elevator, well, a couple of physicists recently come up with another idea. It's a space elevator with a bit of a twist, and they call it the Space Line. And it would actually be, would be able to make it with commercially available materials right now, and it would measure in the billions to make, which really isn't that much, in my opinion. The conventional space elevator idea consists of a cable anchored to the ground that would extend past geosynchronous orbit, which is about 42,000 kilometers above the Earth. The cable's going to need a lot of mass, and at the other end, you're going to need something with, again, a lot of mass to balance the whole thing and stop it from falling down, which will be in orbit. And this whole thing will stay together because of centrifugal force. So the twist in this new idea is, instead of anchoring it to Earth, you'd actually anchor it to the moon and dangle it towards Earth. The space line would inevitably pass through a region where Earth's gravity and the moon's gravity essentially cancel out. And this is known as the Lagrange point. And we could set up like a nice base there and do all sorts of cool research. And they're actually suggesting a proof of principle device that would be about the same thickness as a lead pencil, made of this Xylon stuff, that will stretch from the moon to geosynchronous orbit, and that's going to save so much money. And it would just be extremely cool. At the Lagrange point, you could build like particle accelerators, telescopes, gravitational wave detectors, all sorts of cool stuff. So if there's any Bitcoin billionaires watching, space elevators. Imagine the tourism. Thanks for watching, guys. Make sure you like and subscribe. Leave me a comment down under if you have any good suggestions for things that I can watch. I'm thinking about doing The Expanse next. There's been a lot of comments about that one, so let me know down under. I'll catch you guys next time.